Mahler's Ninth is a long symphony, and I'm presenting it in a single video, so I'll try not to talk much. The work was completed in February 1909, and Mahler never heard it. Its first performance took place under Bruno Walter's direction a little over a year after the composer's death. It is a four-movement work following a remarkable plan not unlike that of Tchaikovsky's Pathétique, composed a couple decades earlier. A slowish first movement pushing towards allegro, followed by a gimpy waltz, a furious march, and a great adagio finale. I do not see any other models that might have served as precedent. In the case of the Ninth, the progressive tonality that was exhibited by some of Mahler's earlier symphonies is also present here, but with a remarkable difference, best understood by comparison perhaps with the Symphony No. 5. That symphony opens with a funeral march in C-sharp minor and ends with a great rondo finale in D major, as though resolving a leading tone over a vast span of time and music. The Seventh Symphony also does something very much like that. The Ninth goes the opposite direction, beginning in D major and ending a half step lower, as if digging into the soil. In this work, as in many before it, Mahler took up topics left unfinished in previous compositions and developed them further. In the present case, there's a great deal of focus on two important motives from Das Lied von der Erde, the three-note stepwise descent representing Beethoven's Lebewohl, and the incomplete version of that motive to which the word Ewig was sung repeatedly at the end of that great song symphony. To those motives, Mahler adds immediately a small catalog at the very beginning of the Ninth, including a faltering heartbeat rhythmic pattern, a three-note chiming figure, and a five-note melodic arch. This small clutch of motives furnishes the material from which vast portions of the opening movement are built, and some of them will also have relevance in later movements. The opening movement is similar in its plan to the remaining three. The process that defines these movements more than anything else is continuous variation, and a powerful rondo-like logic runs through them all. There is, however, at least an overlay of sonata form on movement one, important enough in its shaping influence to be used as the floor plan for my analysis. Both things are true equally, and something like that applies also to the other movements as well. As I said, I'm going to try to hold my words to a minimum, so I'll say very little about the first movement. Its commitment to D major is thorough, and it is, overall, tonally stable music, allowing for some bitonality at a few tormented stretches. Listen for, and watch my commentary for a fleeting indication of, a melodic gruppetto in the first trumpet and first violins at a climactic moment in the development section. That's really the only time you hear that figure in movement one, but it becomes increasingly important through the other three movements until movement four is completely dominated by it. Also, note a sequential trending through the flat submediant during a fragile coda. In other words, a descent by sequence through major thirds. And there is a very evaporative ending, barely an ending at all, barely a resolution of the oboe's unfinished Ewig motive, as tentative a tonic ending as could possibly be imagined. Movement two is a dance movement comprised of three or four dances, depending on how you count them. The first is a rustic landler, almost comic in its effect, and one of its most important guiding motives is the aforementioned three-note Lebewohl descent, here ornamented. This dance functions as a refrain for the whole and sets off appearances of two other dances, a rather inebriated-sounding waltz that tends to run out of control, and a poised, regal second landler that makes thorough use of the Ewig motive. These elements are worked out in something like a musical comedy in rondo form, and the ending poses more questions than answers. The third movement is a torn and outraged A minor rondo movement, which Mahler characterized as a burlesque. Its primary content resides in three highly contrasting themes, two of them marches. The first of those marches is a furiously driven minor key charge that bristles with counterpoint and lashes out mercilessly. The second is a much more delicate little romp that begins over and over and finishes differently each time. And the third theme is a broad, breathed respite in the midst of a raging storm, leisurely in tempo and built almost entirely of the four-note gruppetto that I pointed out in movement one and that was given increasing prominence during movement two. It is from this beautiful musical germ that movement four will later sprout and grow. There are a couple of entertaining fugues in this movement, and one of them quite explicitly forecasts a memorable clarinet moment that will later figure large in the finale. Okay, speaking of that final movement, it is the second of Mahler's great adagio finales, the first having been composed well over a dozen years earlier to close the third symphony. It is, I believe, the greatest thing Mahler ever wrote, and it wrings the heart like no other music I know. There are three themes setting forth the starkest musical contrasts thinkable, placing them in symphonic juxtaposition with each other. The result is just remarkable. With every return of the primary theme, a great hymn-like thing, the music sinks again and again through those flat submediate degrees as though burrowing ever deeper into the protective Mother Earth. And at the movement's climax, the faltering heartbeat motive that opened movement one returns in a heart-wrenching context. The music finally subsides into uncertainty and then resignation, with a final page of score that brings back some of the music of Kindertotenlieder, music that reduces me to tears every time I hear it, and a final few minutes of quietness in which Leonard Bernstein said Mahler came closer than any other composer ever to describing a peaceful death in music. I devoutly hope that Mahler had such a death, and Bernstein too, and that we may all enjoy such a leave-taking when our time comes. The recording is by the Vienna Philharmonic under the direction of Loren Maazel.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.